Henry Lucas and Otis Toole were demented serial killer lovers, brought up in atrocious conditions and inflicted pain and misery amongst those that crossed their paths in the 1960s and 1970s. They travelled America together, raping, murdering and cannibalising their victims. And if Henry's testimonies are to be believed, they killed more than 600 people. It's an astonishing claim, and the crimes committed were so twisted and vile, it's enough to make anyone's skin crawl. Henry and Otis both met at a soup kitchen in 1976 and hit it off from the very first day. They moved fast. Before night fell, Lucas was back at Toole's home, sharing a bed with a man he just met. Their lives had run along parallel lines. Both men were raised by abusive mothers who were frustrated that they didn't have daughters and had forced their sons to wear dresses. Both men had suffered horrible sexual trauma before they turned 10, and by the time they met, both men were murderers. Lucas served 10 years in prison for the murder of his own mother. She was a prostitute, and when Lucas was a young boy, she would force him to sit in the room and watch while she serviced her customers. He lost an eye when he was 10 because she ignored an infection for so long that he had to have it removed. She'd given him a miserable life. By the time he reached puberty, Lucas was passing his spare time torturing animals and sexually assaulting his own brother. He was 23 years old when he killed his mother in 1960. The two had gotten into an argument and she physically confronted her son. She struck him across the face and in the heat of the moment, he hit her back. All I remember was slapping her alongside the neck, he would later reveal to police. When I went to pick her up, I realised she was dead. Then I noticed I had a knife in my hand and she had been cut. Toole's childhood was even harder. He was assaulted by almost every person he thought he could trust. His mother dressed him up as a girl, his older sister raped him before he turned 10, and his father, the worst of them all, prostituted him to a neighbour when he was only 5 years old. Toole was already a serial arsonist and a suspect in four murder cases by the time he met Lucas. His first murder victim was a travelling salesman who he tried to pick up for sex in the early 1960s. Toole was only 14 years old when he lured that man into the woods and then ran him over with his own car. It was the first time he'd ever killed anyone, but murder for Toole would soon become an addiction. Considering the deeply disturbing past of these two men, it didn't take them long before they decided to embark on a murdering spree together. They both travelled across 26 states in the 1970s, murdering as many people as they could find. They preyed upon hitchhikers, prostitutes, and migrant workers. They would pick them up and lure them off to a quiet area, and then kill them. Murder for them was just a way that a young couple could bond. They would talk about it openly. Lucas later claimed that it would teach Toole on how to get away with it. He was doing his crimes all one way, Lucas would later say. I started to correct him in his ways, in doing the crime where he wouldn't leave information. Their crimes were horrible. Often they would sexually assault their victims before killing them and mutilate them beyond recognition afterward. Lucas would later say that he didn't feel the slightest moment of guilt. He once even joked that he crossed two state lines with someone's severed head in the back seat. Toole enjoyed devouring their bodies. It was something that he and Lucas were caught discussing in a private conversation over a prison phone years later after they both had been arrested. The way Toole talked about cannibalism, it almost sounded like something worth being nostalgic about. Remember how I like to pour some blood out of them? He asked Lucas. Some taste like real meat when it's got barbecue sauce on it. The relationship fell apart when Lucas became interested in Toole's younger teenage niece, Becky Powell. He would later say that he liked having someone young to look up to him, and there was no one better than a child. He ran off with her and left Toole alone. Toole was so upset that he allegedly killed 9 people just to blow off some steam. Lucas and Powell didn't make it very far though. She would soon learn just how much of a dangerous man he really was after their pair got into a fight while at the ranch at Ringgold in Texas. There he lured her to an isolated field, murdered her, dismembered her body, and scattered the pieces in the field. Then, for no reason other than a twisted urge, he lured the woman who owned the ranch out to the same field, killed her, and stuffed her body into a drainage pipe. Soon after this rampage, Lucas was arrested in Texas in 1983. Meanwhile, Toole was separately imprisoned in Florida in 1984 for burning a 64-year-old man alive. At long last, the killer couple was behind bars. Originally, Lucas was only arrested for possession of a deadly weapon, but is only too eager to incriminate himself for every crime he could. He talked about his murders to any police officer who would listen to him. On the other hand, Tool was a little bit more reluctant, but after Lucas started talking to cops on the guided tours about murder sites, Tool began backing up his former lover's claims. By his count, they murdered 108 people, including 6-year-old Adam Walsh, the son of future America's Most Wanted host, John Walsh. Otis Tool insisted he was a young boy's murderer, even arguing with police when they didn't believe him, telling them, "Oh, no, I killed him too, there's no doubt about that." Meanwhile, Lucas ended up confessing to more than 600 murders in total, although it's generally accepted that he wasn't telling the truth about all of them. As Lucas would later admit, confessing to crimes won him extra privileges. The police would drive him out to the scene of the crime and let him even get fast food along the way. For a man who had already been sentenced to death row, confessing to murder upon murder was just a way to spend some time outside. "I made the police look stupid," Lucas later boasted. "I was out to wreck Texas law enforcement." Considering Lucas and Tool's true body count remains unknown, it's only natural people would start to wonder how many of their confessions were actually lies. His never-ending list of omissions led to the Texas Rangers establishing Henry Lee Lucas Task Force, specifically assigned to oversee the crimes that the serial killer claimed to be responsible for committing. At first, every story Lucas told seemed to be like the real deal. After all, he offered a gratuitous amount of grisly details of his supposed crime scenes. He even drew detailed pictures of his alleged victims that were so precise that they even included eye colour. But then, his confessions began to slowly unravel. Law enforcement began to pick up on some major discrepancies in Lucas's timelines. Plus, DNA testing started to contradict some of his stories. It didn't help that Lucas didn't offer much hard evidence to back up his increasingly far-fetched tales. It was later revealed that some of the members of the task force assigned to him secretly provided him with evidence and asked him leading questions in an attempt to get more confessions. That said, some of Texas Rangers remained convinced that he was telling the truth about at least some of the murders. "I remember him trying to cop one he didn't do," said Texas Ranger Glenn Elliott. "But there was another murder case where I'll kiss your butt if he didn't lead us to the deer stand where the murder took place. Ain't no way he could have guessed that, and I damn sure didn't tell him. I think he did that one." There's no telling how much of Lucas and Tool's story is true. The impact, though, endures. The police closed 213 cold cases based on their confessions. A district attorney named Ken Anderson, who prosecuted Lucas, said he believed the murderer had killed anywhere from 3 to 12 people. "I don't think he knew exactly," Anderson said. "It's difficult to imagine you can rely on anything he said, but the fact remains, he was a serial killer, even though we're unable to pinpoint the exact number." Lucas died of heart failure in jail in 2001, so any definitive answers of how many people he killed died with him. Meanwhile, Tool died of liver cancer in jail in 1996. The possible false confessions from the killers have had horrifying consequences for the families of murder victims. They went from feeling a sense of closure that Lucas and Tool were behind bars to questioning whether those men had ever killed their loved ones in the first place. In the worst case scenario, the real killers behind some of the fake admissions might still be out there. It's no wonder why some families are now lobbying to get cases reopened, years after the couple's confessions closed them up. Regardless of how much truth there is to this story, it's undeniable that these serial killers left a horrible scar on America from which it still hasn't recovered.